singing Dear Lord and Father of Mankind.
Welcome to what is a very special, although bittersweet day. A special day in that this is Ray's last Sunday with us, and as you can see, he's designed the music to be a particular treat, and what a treat it is, and what a joy. But also bittersweet because it is Ray's last Sunday with us, and we will miss you terribly, Ray. And you're haven't only added to the quality of the service, but have really added to the quality of the church, having you as part of our church family. There will be reception afterwards. I hope you'll stay for that. So that's a big day. And then it's also a big day because we have a baptism this morning. And we are just thrilled to be baptizing Jacob. And he just gave me a big smile when I said that. So that's a great thing as well. And so our service continues on page Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Skipping down about two-thirds of the page, there is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the first lesson.
The first reading is from the book of Job. There was once a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. One day, the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still persists in his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him for no reason." Then Satan answered the Lord, "Skin for skin. All that people have they will give to save their lives. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, he is in your power. Only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and inflicted loathsome sores on Job, from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Job took a potsherd with which to scrape himself and sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as any foolish woman would speak. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is Psalm 26 in your bulletin insert, and let's read it responsively, breaking at the whole verse. I'll start, and the congregation will respond with the even verses. "Give judgment for me, O Lord, for I have lived with integrity. I have trusted in the Lord and have not faltered. For your love is before my eyes. I have walked faithfully with you.
I have not sat with the worthless, nor dwelt in sorrow with the deceitful.
I have hated the company of evildoers. I will not sit down with the wicked.
I will wash my hands in innocence, O Lord, that I may go in procession around your altar."
Singing aloud a song of thanksgiving, and recounting all your wonderful deeds.
"Lord, I love the house which you dwell, and the place where your glory lies."
"Do not sweep me away with sinners, nor my life with those who thirst for blood.
Whose hands are full of evil plots, and their right hand full of bribes.
As for me, I will live with integrity. Redeem me, O Lord, and have pity on me.
My foot stands on level ground. In the full assembly, I will bless the Lord."
The second reading is from Hebrews. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in those days, last days, he had spoken to us by a son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he had inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world about which we are speaking to angels, but someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in whom many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked him, Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Jesus answered them, What did Moses command you? They said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her. But Jesus said to them, Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment. But from the beginning, God made them male and female. For this reason, the man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one set asunder. Then in the house, the disciples asked Jesus again about this matter. He said to them, Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. In the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our salvation.
Amen.
Please be seated. Well, today we continue our sermon series, Go Big or Go Home. And our theme today is to go big in our relationships, to believe big things are possible in the relationships that mean the most for us. The whole point of this sermon series is that we would take what has been given to us, the time that's been given to us, our one short life, that we would take the gifts and abilities that have been given to us, that we would take the resources that have given to us, and we would make the most of them in doing the very best we can in loving the people and planet that matter to us. So that we would take the things that have been given to us, do the very best we can with those things, and make the most of those things in doing the very best we can to love the people and planet around us. And this morning's gospel talks about just that. It talks about going big in our relationships, and it makes clear that God's intention for us is that we would have good relationships, is that we would love one another. And though it speaks about marriage and it speaks about loving our children, those aren't meant to be the only relationship God is talking about. Jesus is just talking about these as representative relationships. But he might also be talking about friendships. He might also be talking about co-workers. The point is that whatever our relationships are, God intends for us to have good relationships. It's God's intention that we would never fail to love, that we would love all people, everywhere, all the time. And the great thing about God is that God adds attention to his intention. So he adds attention to his intention, and that allows God to act on his love. But we don't always do the same. I think we share our intentions with God. We also intend to have good relationships. We also intend to love all people all the time. But too often for us, for me, it stops with intention, and I don't add attention to it. Nobody who gets married, I just did a marriage yesterday, nobody, a wedding yesterday, nobody who gets married intends for that marriage to come apart. And yet sometimes marriages do. Nobody who has children intends to neglect their kids. And yet so often kids get neglected. Nobody who has a faith experience, who desires to be a spiritual person, who perhaps with great particularity met Jesus somewhere along the line in their life. Nobody who does that intends to neglect their faith, intends to neglect their spiritual life. Nobody who baptizes a child intends to neglect the spiritual life of that child. And yet, so often, we do neglect our spiritual life. We do neglect our faith. We do neglect our relationship with Jesus Christ. And why is that? It's because we don't add attention to our intention. And so what we're talking about is having a bias for action. And when we add attention to intention, that creates this bias for action. One of the things that people often say is the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence. Well, why is that? It's because somebody has paid attention to the grass on the other side of the fence. And so because of that attention, they've watered that grass, they've weeded that grass, they fertilized that grass, they protected that grass from people trampling upon it, and that's why that grass is greener, because not only has a person intended to have greener grass, but they've added action, attention and acted in such a way to create greener grass. And so this morning, we want to talk quite specifically about how we can add attention to intention so that we too can have a bias towards action and make the most of the relationships in our lives. So our first point is that we don't want to wait in doing the things that we can do to show the people around us how much we love them. And the quote that we have there, and I need to give credit where credit is due, is that Trevor made these slides for me. Trevor is our youth minister. He actually preached for me last night because I wasn't here. I was doing a wedding. And he put these quotes in here, and I don't really know where they came from. Like, here's this quote here. Do or do not, there is no try. Anybody recognize that? Yoda, okay, Star Wars, where Luke is learning to use a force and raises X-Wing out of the swamp, right? Trevor told me that. I wouldn't really know that. But do or do not, there is no try. And that is the difference between just having intention and adding attention to our intention and actually doing something. That's the difference between trying and doing, all right? So the person who tries to have a good relationship is going to be in a very different place than the person who has a good relationship. You see, just trying to have a good relationship, that means I intend to have a good relationship. The person who tries to make a relationship work, they intend to do that, but the person who says, I'm going to make a relationship work, see, that person's added attention to it, and they're going to do what needs to be done to make that relationship work. The person who says, I'm going to try and have good friendships, they're probably not going to have good friendships because their attention is going to be somewhere else. They're going to be paying attention to their work. They're going to be paying attention to, you know, to something else in their life. But the person who says, I am going to be a good friend, you see, that person's going to have friendships in their life. The person who says, I'm going to try and make my marriage work, chances are that person's not going to have good marriage. The person who says, I'm going to make my marriage work, That person's going to have good marriage because they're going to have added attention to their intention. I'm going to try and make my marriage work. I intend to have a good marriage, but my attention is elsewhere. My attention is on my job. That's where I spend most of my attention. It's on my job. My job's going well. My marriage isn't. It's on alcohol or painkillers or prescription drugs or on some hobby or interest. And those things are going really well because that's where my attention is. It's not really on the marriage. I intend to have a good marriage, but actually I've got a certain interest in somebody on the side. Well, that relationship probably going really well, though my marriage isn't going quite so well because that's where I'm paying attention. And we call these things escape hatches. So the person who says, I'm going to try and make my relationship work, but their attention is elsewhere on these escape hatches, they're not really working on their relationship. It's only when you close those escape hatches and you no longer try to make a relationship work, but you say, by golly, I'm going to make that relationship work, that a person makes that relationship work. You might say it this way. Our culture says that we're supposed to marry the person we love. Jesus teaches us that we're supposed to love the person we marry. So there's a world of difference between those two. Marry the person you love and love the person you marry. That's a difference between trying, I'm going to try and do that, and doing. I'm going to try and be a good dad, but my attention is on my job. My attention is going fishing. My attention is on this, doing that. And you see, my intention's there, but I haven't added attention to it, and so I don't act in such a way that really is in the best interest of my children, and I neglect them. All right? So that's our first point. Do or do not. There is no try. So important. Second point is we want to beat the stats. And this other quote, anybody know where this one comes from? Never tell me the odds. Another Trevor quote. Han Solo heading into the asteroid field. I'm proud of you for knowing that. That's good. Another Star Wars quote. This is Han Solo about to navigate an asteroid field, and he says, never tell me the odds. And this is such an interesting thing. Again, if we just go with intention to be a good parent, to be a good spouse, to be a good Christian, but we don't add attention to it, we're actually going to become very average. We're just going to go with cultural drift. Our culture is going to shape us. If we don't add the attention to be very intentional in living out what matters to us, we're going to become average. And you know what? Nobody in this area wants an average kid, right? I mean, nobody in this area wants an average. And probably nobody wants. We all want to live in Lake Wobegon where all our kids are above average. All our kids are beautiful and all our kids are above average. And yet we settle for being average Americans in so many ways. And it's so interesting to look at the statistics on what makes an average American. It's a lot of fun. So I did some Googling on, or Binging, I call it, because I like Bing a lot better than Google. They have better pictures. But Bing's a search engine also. If you don't use it, you really should. Pictures are great. I forgot what I was Binging now. Oh, yeah, average American. Binging the average American. And so the average American, if you're the average American woman, you spend $360 on shoes a year and have 12 pairs of shoes in your closet already. If you're the average American man, you spend $5,674 on beer. Okay, I just made that one up. I just made that up. But it sounds about right to me. I mean, that sounds like that could probably be true, right? I mean, that sounds like... Let's go with some real statistics. In America, the average person spends $21 a week on coffee. Now, that might sound like too much until you realize that there are a whole lot of Americans who don't drink a drop of coffee, right? There's a lot of tea drinkers. I'm a tea drinker. I've never drank a drop of coffee in my life. And so for the average person to drink $21 worth of coffee a week, they got to compensate for all those people who spend zero. So the average is probably more like $40 or $50 a week. And the person who stops at Starbucks every day, on their way into work or whatever, I mean, they're spending $5 or $6 a pop on their coffee, depending. And that's going to be $40 a week, and that's going to be several thousand dollars a year. That's the average American. How does that happen? Well, the person intends to be, let's say the person intends to be generous, but they don't really pay much attention to being generous, and so they spend all the money that they could spend on really being generous on coffee instead. Who really wants to be average like that? Car payments. I mean, car payments are scary. The average car loan now is 66 months. So 6.5 years, right? 5.5 years. And I never was good at math. And now the 84-month loans are the loans that are increasing in number the most rapidly. The average car purchase price right now is almost $28,000, and the average car payment right now is $484. Somewhere I saw $600, but I'm going to throw that one out because I couldn't verify it. But I've seen in several places $484. A lot of people have two car payments. Think about that for a second. If you're 30 years old, you buy a car for the average payment, $484. You could have invested that money, got an average return, will go with a low rate, 8%. You don't take that money out until you retire 35. That car cost you over $1 million. Hope you like that car. Do we really want to be an average American in what we do with our money in terms of relation to, you know, my grandparents, my parents, they never ever dreamed of taking out a car loan. And they don't seem to suffer too much for that. Do we really want to be the average American in that regard? Generosity. The average American gives 2.3% of their income away. And actually, the richer you get, the less you give away. The lowest levels of income in America, they give 4.4% of their income away. Once you get above $75,000, that drops to 1.8%. Do you really want to be an average American? See, probably all of us say, we want to be generous. Who doesn't want to be generous? I intend to be generous, but unless I add attention to that and say, I'm going to be generous, then we're just going to, by drift, by cultural influence, we're just going to be average and spend our money the way that everybody else does, and generosity is not going to be possible for us. If we want to follow Jesus Christ, if we want to be a spiritual person, I mean, if you're not a Christian right now, you can just relax and breathe a sigh of relief, because this isn't for you, okay? You can just say, okay, talking to somebody else, thank God, just, you know, sit back and relax. But if you're a Christian, I mean, Jesus said some real specific things about these things. And unless we add attention to intention, we're never going to be faithful in following Jesus. And saying we're Christians, it's just going to be a bunch of smoke. And none of us who are Christians, I think, want that. I mean, we really do want to follow Jesus. We want our actions to follow words, but attention has to follow intention. Last point, is we have to learn to embrace failure. We have to learn to celebrate failure, actually. And there's an old saying, and there's another quote on this. I have no idea where this one comes. Where Trevor gets these things, I don't know. Strike me down, and I'll become more powerful than you could possibly imagine. Where does that come from? Star Wars again. Who is that, Chris? Obi-Wan. Yes, Obi-Wan. And who does he say that to? Darth Vader. And does Darth Vader strike him down?
Yes, sir, it does.
And does he become more powerful than he could ever?
Yes,
he does. That's right. So, yeah. And in many ways, this is the sort of cultural reenactment of the ancient Christian story, where Jesus also is struck down. Jesus dies penniless, forsaken, ashamed, violent, and out of this defeat, out of this failure, God does infinitely more than we could ever ask or imagine. And so failure is the price of growth. Failure is the price of learning. And the thing I like to say, you know, there's this old saying, anything worth doing is doing well. Well, the saying I like even better is, anything worth doing is worth doing not well. Well, what do you mean by that? I mean, if we're ever going to learn to do something well, we have to first be willing to do something not well. We have to first be willing to do something poorly. Anybody ever ride a bike? Anybody ever get it on the very first time? Maybe one or two of you who are genetically gifted and athletes. Yes, we hate people like that, but we'll love you here because this is church. Me? I grew up 1147 Clemson Drive. There was a real steep hill. I figured, you know, why learn to pedal and balance at the same time? I'll just get on my bike and I'll just glide down the hill. That did not end well. But I got back on the bike. You know, when we first started riding bikes, how many of us use training wheels? All right, that's riding a bike poorly. That's riding a bike not well, training wheels. But training wheels helped us to learn how to ride a bike. So if we failed, but we celebrated that failure, got back on, ultimately we learned how to ride a bike. And now there's a lot of joy that comes in learning how to ride a bike. You may not know this about me. I'm actually very, very introverted. What that means is that even though I can play an extroverted role, like I have to go home and take a nap because this takes a lot of energy out of me. And so what that means for me, what that's meant for me in my marriage, my wife is a little concerned because she heard I mentioned her, but really I'm just talking about me. So in my marriage as an introvert, it's been hard for me to learn to speak the language of feelings to my wife. The place I'm most comfortable is inside of me. It's hard for me to communicate at all. And you see, for a lot of men, it's hard for them to speak the language of feelings to their wives. A, we have no idea what's going on inside of us in the first place. I mean, you know, we just really don't even know. And B, feeling words? What the heck are feeling words? We don't know feeling words. I mean, those. And C, we've been taught to be tough, not tender. You know, to be tough, not vulnerable. So we're not, you know, to risk actually showing what's going on in our hearts, who of us is going to do that? We might get hurt. And yet I was fortunate because early on in my life, because of my church family, because of some of the mentors in the church, including my first boss, Ernie Bennett, because of my own dad, I came to realize how important it was that I learned to speak the language of feelings. And when a person really begins to speak the language of feelings, you don't do it well. I mean, I think I insulted my wife instead of saying something. I was trying to say something nice, but I just kind of got it all wrong, and you know, and we end up with a misunderstanding. And it felt very awkward, and I felt embarrassed, and you know, I didn't do it well at all. And truth is, 30-some years later, I still don't always do it well. But the truth also is, of all the gifts that I have ever given my wife, of all the gifts I've ever given my wife, I think the thing that she appreciates more than any other thing is that when I have tried to learn, not when I've tried to learn, when I have learned to speak the language of feelings. I mean, I think that is the greatest gift, really, that one human being can give to another, is to just really open ourselves up to each other. But if we're not in the habit of doing that, if we've been taught to protect ourselves rather than to share ourselves, when we start trying to do that, we will not do it well. And the only way to do it well is to first be willing to do it poorly. So we need to celebrate failure. When I got up to do the last sermon, a little kid up front said, uh-oh, that wasn't really encouraging. So you got to be willing to do things, you know, yeah. So my point in all this is that I'd really hope that as we go big in our relationships, dream big things for our relationships, that we would have a bias towards action, that we would put our love into practice rather than playing it safe, rather than being overly analytical, rather than protecting ourselves, that we would, you know, that we really would do rather than just try, that we would beat the odds, not just drift into the statistics, and that we would be willing to do things poorly in order that one day we might be able to do things well. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, and now we get to do a baptism, which is exciting. Parents and godparents, I think this might be for you.
Yes, sir.
Candidate for baptism will now be presented. Oh, and that's your first red line. I present
Jacob to receive the sacrament of baptism.
Will you be responsible for seeing that Jacob is brought up in the Christian faith and life?
I will, with God's help.
Will you, by your prayers and witness, help Jacob to grow into the full stature of Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Here's our interesting thing. Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce them.
You turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior.
I do.
You put your whole trust in his grace and love.
I do.
You promise to follow and obey him as your Lord.
I do.
Now all of us who are witnessing these vows have an opportunity to express our love and support for Jacob by responding to the following question, I do. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support Jacob in his life in Christ?
We will.
Fantastic, because I think I told you to say the wrong thing. let us now stand and join with Jacob, who is committing himself to Christ, and renew our own baptismal covenant. You believe in God the Father.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
You believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. Right hand of God. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers?
I will with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will with God's help.
We proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ.
I will with God's help.
You seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself.
I will with God's help.
We strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being.
I will with God's help.
Let us now pray for Jacob, who has received the sacrament of new birth.
Deliver Jacob, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open his heart to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill Jacob with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep him in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach Jacob to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send him into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring Jacob to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer. Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, the Holy Spirit led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your Son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who are here cleansed from sin and born again, they continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Amen. All right. Jacob, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son. Okay, and of the Holy Spirit. Oh, see? Full participation, that's exactly, yep. Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, that's good. I made a friend, yeah. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit you've bestowed upon Jacob the forgiveness of sin and have raised him to the new life of grace. Sustain Jacob, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give him an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage and will to persevere, the spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen. Best baptism ever, I'll tell you what. All right. Jacob, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. You want to see that too? Okay. And now if you want to walk Jacob up and down the aisle so everybody can see the newest member of our church family. You can walk with her. Using losing the sentence about two-thirds of the way down the page on 308, actually almost at the bottom of the page. Let us welcome the newly baptized. We receive you into the household of God, confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us his eternal priesthood. And this candle is lit in... Good job, Cheryl. I think you got it. Thank you very much. That's great. All right, and that's lit as a symbol of the light of Christ, which burns in Jacob's heart. And though, after all that work, you can extinguish it. We ask that you light the candle again on the anniversaries of his baptism and help him understand what occurred here today as he lives into his faith. The peace of the Lord be always with you. There's a box. Congratulations. Congratulations. You really did do great. I mean, that really is sort of the spirit to which it should happen. Oh, that was fantastic. Godspeed. Good morning. It is good to see everybody this morning. Good to have you with us. And so we welcome you here today. If you never received baptism in an Episcopal church, everybody is welcome at what we believe is the Lord's table, not the domain of any particular church or denomination. So everybody's free to come and receive with us. If you don't want to receive communion, but you simply want to come forward and be blessed, in a generic way, as a part of the human family participating in this event, we invite you to come to the altar in that regard as well. There are a lot of announcements in your bulletin, and we pray that you would take a look at them there. So, for instance, we have our pet blessing this afternoon at 5 o'clock, and that's always great. So come on out, bring your pets. The more pets and the more varied the pets, the better. In a couple of weeks, we have our Oktoberfest celebration. That's one of the highlights of the year, and it's a very authentic Oktoberfest celebration. Ute brings her German background so that our Oktoberfest is sehr gut, and it is always a good time together. The week after that, we'll have exploding pumpkins, and we're trying to find some ways to take that even further over the top than in years past, so you won't want to miss that, and a costume party for our kids, and that will be a lot of fun. Another announcement that we're very excited about is a way to add attention to intention as we grow in our faith, through a class that's going to be offered by Anna Rosa. So Anna, if you would tell us a little bit about that, we'd be grateful.
Thank you, Father. Hello, everyone. My name is Anna Rosa. As Father was saying, I'm here to talk about the event that we're going to have this Wednesday. It's called The Wholehearted Journey. It's an invitation to a new way of going through life, a new way of dealing with our relationships. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Brené Brown. Those that are familiar with her, where it's the daring way, which is I'm certified in her methodology. And a lot of what Father Rob was saying today is very much aligned with the way she wants us, or she's inviting us to go through life so that our relationships become better, more authentic, with a deeper sense of connection. And although sometimes we do have the good intention, it's hard for us to walk the way we want to do. So this is what it's going to be about. I thank Father for the opportunity. It's my first time doing this kind of thing in a Christian community. So for me, it's really awesome, and I'm feeling very much vulnerable right now talking to you guys because of that. So I hope to see you on Wednesday so that we can talk a little bit more about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. So we're looking forward to it. And let me just say a particular word to men. One of the people who has been most helpful to me and been trying to become the man that I really want to be has been Brené Brown. And her writings, I think she does a great job of capturing the male experience, and in particular the really painful parts of it that a lot of times people haven't understood that make us who we are. And she gives us a path out of that. I've read a ton, Brené Brown has been so helpful to me. So I think this is a great opportunity for us. It's 1 hour on Wednesday night. We waste an hour on a lot of things. This isn't a waste, but I'm saying, even if you might not think it's for you, check it out. Give it a chance. It's an hour. And if you say it's not for me, that's okay. But if you find it's as helpful for you as it is for me, you'll just be so glad you came. So consider joining us this Wednesday night, because it's going to be a very special time together. Trevor, you look vaguely different today. I can't quite put my finger on it, but something looks, I don't know, a little different.
I lost a bet.
Oh, yeah? And what bet was that?
With you.
I thought you were supposed to dye your beard.
I tried.
There is no try.
Yeah, okay.
We have the evidence.
Yeah, so if you do want to see a picture of me with what was, honestly, dye as bright as the carpet in this room all over my face, please do. You can check it out on Instagram. Maybe I'll post it to Facebook as well, but if you search St. Matt's Youth on Instagram, you'll find it. It looked like I just had fire truck paint on my face. And this is what happened. So I guess, you know, you can go anywhere and buy hair dye. I don't know if anyone knows where they manufacture beard dye, but I'm not sure it exists.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for
talking. So, I do indeed concede that the Old Testament was victorious at the Episcopal.
Yep. We couldn't get out of bed the next day, but we won.
I also just want to invite all of our high school and middle school age people to Sunday Night Live, the best possible thing that you could be doing on a Sunday night. It's a really great time that we come together in fellowship, have a lot of fun, spend some small group time and some study time in the Word. If you would like to join us, it's from 6:30 until 8:30 in the trailer tonight, every Sunday night. And I hope to see some of our young folks here. And I hope that everyone else has a fantastic Sunday. So please do that.
All right. And again, please join us afterwards for reception celebrating Ray's ministry here at St. Matthew's. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. You know that a communion prayer is actually a prayer of great thanksgiving. The word Eucharist in Greek quite literally means great thanksgiving. And it's meant to tie up all the things that we're thankful for in our thankfulness for all that God has done for us, and particularly for all that God has done for us in Jesus. And it's sometimes people offer communion prayers with special intention or special thanks. And so we offer this communion prayer with special intention, with special thanks for the life and ministry of Ray, for the way that Ray has gone big and not gone home, the way he's dared to dream big dreams and make impossible things happen, like making it snow in the sanctuary on Christmas time, bringing what we believe is some of the very best music in this area, and for the way that Ray continues to inspire us by going big in his dreams of pursuing God's call upon his life, even when that's not comfortable or convenient. So we offer this in thanksgiving for you, Ray. Let's stand and continue our worship. Eucharistic Prayer B, page 367. Page 367. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Father Almighty. And therefore we join in our voices as we praise you with angels and dark angels and with all the company of heaven. We'll forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Give thanks to, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, the calling of Israel to be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent unto me incarnate from the Virgin Mary to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. And the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, bring us to that heavenly country where, with St. Matthew and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ. using the prayer found on page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you this day and always. Shawl and encourage all of you to join me there so that you can greet Ray and express your appreciation to him personally. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah.